Let God be God. This is a call to intimacy with God. As a disciple, we are first of all called to an intimate relationship with God. It is that place that we are able to hear Him and fully trust and surrender everything to Him. You know, it's something like a child dancing with the father. She gently places her foot on his feet. And together, you know, it's like a rhythm and a dance that's being led by the Father. She gazes at Him, mesmerized by His love. And in this place, she's fully trusting Him. And even if she should stumble, He picks her up again and leads her one more time. It is intimacy with the Father, being led by Him. It is His desire to lead us every step of the way, and for us to place our hands in His hands and to be led by our God. He knows what is the best for us. There are times when the storms of life will hit us, and it can be really frightening. It can be a place of fear, deep fear. Things may come in one after another. And it is in that place where we are able to make Scripture come alive, because we have that communion with the Father. For it says in Isaiah 41:13-14, "For I am the Lord your God, who takes hold of your right hand and says to you, do not fear, I will help you. Do not be afraid, you worm Jacob. Little Israel, do not fear, for I myself will help you, declares the Lord, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel." Don't we sometimes feel like a worm? We feel so little compared to the problems, the humongous problems that we face. But yet the Lord says, "I am your God." He is our Father. And in verse 15 it says, "I will make you into a threshing sledge, new and sharp with many teeth. You will thresh the mountains and crush them and reduce the hills to chaff." You know, in this verse He reminds us that not only is He intimately close to us, but in the place of waiting, in the place of trust, He's actually building inside of us strength to fight the battles, strength to overcome. And out of that, we are able to set others free. This closeness draws us to that place of hunger where we desire more and more of His presence. We want to know Him more in His Word. You know, that place of intimacy is actually a place where we are being filled by Him. And therefore, ministry is an outflow. Ministry will flow out of that place of intimacy. In Zephaniah 3:17, it says, "The Lord your God is with you, the mighty warrior who says, He will take great delight in you, in His love. He will no longer rebuke you, but will rejoice over you with singing." Sometimes in my quiet times in worship, I feel like I'm truly dancing with Father God. And I know that this is this place that He wants us to come intimately in this relationship with Him. So as His disciples, let us all come to that place where we will truly dance with our Father.
I used to be a beggar, down on calloused knees, till
Rushing out of the doubt into trust, out of the me into us. No turning back, no turning back, no turning back. I'm falling head over heels into love, leaving regret in the dust. No turning back, no turning back, no turning back. No turning back, no. And if I'm caught in the crossfire, I will stand my ground.
As a disciple of Jesus Christ, we have now been given a new identity in Christ. The book of Ephesians chapter 1 says we are chosen, we are adopted to sonship as His sons and daughters. We have a God-given identity that changes our very DNA. In truly following Jesus, we develop a discipleship DNA. And this is not a superficial change, but it is deeply rooted in our relationship with Jesus Christ. We no longer live for ourselves. This new purpose is built by our seeking first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. This new purpose is also for us to know Christ and to make Him known, to love Him and to love one another. The Bible urges us to run, but not just to run. The Bible gives us a specific way in which we are to run. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1 and 2 says, "Therefore, Since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of weaknesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. Let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. Life is not a short race. It is the race of life. Sometimes we get discouraged, we stumble, we fall, and we struggle. However, the beauty of the Word of God is that we are called in this new identity to be grafted into the family of God. The Bible says this is the body of Christ. We do not run alone. This togetherness is a very powerful truth. It helps us to stay on track. It encourages us on our journey as disciples. We care for one another. We love one another. We run together. We are a community of believers that are better together. And when we do that, John chapter 13 verse 35 says, "By this everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another." We have a new identity, a new purpose and destiny. We are running together as disciples, as a community. Would you follow after Jesus? Would you lay your life to be aligned to Christ in the days ahead? Let us run the race together with Jesus as the person we look towards in this journey.
Question mark. This is for the outcast soul, lost control, no one knows. Sing it for the can't go back. Sing it for the broken past. Sing it for the just found out life is now upside down.
If you're looking for hope tonight, raise your hand. If you feel alone and don't loved in vain, overcame, it's not too late.
Together. tonight. If you're in the fight of your life, we're gonna make it hand in hand.
I will be by your side. It's love in the air tonight. I'll help you see the light. We're gonna make it together.
Together with our differences, together we are bolder, braver, stronger.
Second Corinthians chapter 5 verse 17 tells us, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he or she is a new creation. All things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. When we make that decision to follow Jesus, we begin our new life as newborn babes. And as in the natural, we need to grow as part of the family of God, which is the church.
I can remember even buying so many Lego sets for my children, and I always can remember, you know, the excited faces of my children when they get this new set and they pour out the many pieces and they want to get at it. And very quickly, you would see that they are struggling and they can't find the right pieces. And lo and behold, Mommy and Daddy would just come and said, we could do it together. So as a Christian, I have been very blessed that when I first accepted the Lord, I was truly blessed to have a group of more mature Christians who came alongside me, who then, you know, week after week taught me how to read the Bible, how to pray. And eventually, they even taught me how to go out and share my faith. And I really thank God that those times where these older Christians came to disciple me, it has helped me to build a strong foundation so that I can be a disciple of Jesus Christ. In Hebrews chapter 4 verse 12, it says, the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates to dividing the soul and spirit, joint and marrow. It judges the thoughts and the attitudes of the heart. Being able to chew on the Word of God will allow us to take root in the promises of God. When we do that, the Word of God becomes an anchor and a security for our faith in the Lord. I am sure that all of you would agree with me that the expectation for all living things is for them to continue growing. So what happens when these living things stop growing? It means it's a sign that they're starting to die. So as Christians, we need to have this mindset of growth, one where we would dig deep into the Word of God so that we would allow ourselves to be able to understand more of the truth of Christ. That even as I mature in my spiritual life, I was able to attempt and overcome more difficult challenges in life. Like a child, even as we grow up, you know, we were able to attempt, you know, more difficult Lego sets.
And even as we grow in Christ, we will be able to bear fruits. We become blessings to the people around us. We become the disciples that Jesus wants us to be, reflecting His glory and His image. The challenge for us today is that we must desire to grow and to seek after God's things so that continually we will become more and more like Jesus, so that whatever He calls us to do, we will be ready to do it as disciples of Jesus Christ.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my turn till I made. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my turn, yeah, till I made. You called my name and I
Good morning, FGA. Welcome to our online service. It's a blessing to be able to invite God's presence into our homes this morning. Let's prepare our hearts now to worship God and come before Him. Put aside all our worries, and as we worship Him, may His goodness and His presence and His greatness overflow in you and your homes. Let's pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you that you are the King of Kings, and yet you have called us your people and your children. God, we just want to come before you and worship you. How wonderful it is to come and adore your greatness, O God. And God, draw us close to you this morning as we worship you. And let us experience your presence, Lord, in our homes, in our families. And we just look to you, Jesus. We praise you because you are good, good God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
A very good morning, FGA. We are so glad that you can join us for online service this morning. Let us set our eyes towards heaven and set our hearts towards God as we praise and worship Him. For we worship a God that has done great things. Amen.
Great things.
praise you, God, for you have done great things, Lord, in our lives. You have done many miracles, many wonderful deeds throughout our lifetime and in the past as well, Lord. And we believe that we will see more to come in future years.
Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. Thank you. done great things. Great are you, Lord. Yes, we declare. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praises. Pour out our praise, it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. Pour out our praise, it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out.
Indeed, our God is awesome God. How great is He! Our hearts will cry and our bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. He is greater than every single challenges and worries that we are facing today, tomorrow, and in the future. Because He is ever faithful, and we have seen how He has overcome for us, how He has come through. From the creation of the world all the way until today, until Jesus returned again, that He brings life to the lifeless, He gives hope to the hopeless, and He brings light to the darkness. And in His light, there is no darkness. So church, can I encourage you to close your eyes and just bring before God every single worry you have, whether it is for your personal needs, your finances, your health, your mental health, or it could even be things that you have not want to care about, you have brushed aside, you don't really want to deal with it anymore, you just let it run on autopilot. Or it can be something that for your loved ones, you just don't know how to deal with it for your loved ones. Let's just bring it to God, because He cares, He sees, He knows. And He is here to answer our prayers. Let's pray together. Oh God, we just pray for every single needs that we don't know, but You know it all. And we just pray, Lord, that Your goodness, Your presence will come into these situations and You will take over, Jesus. That we proclaim Your name, we declare Your goodness in this situation. And when You come, Your presence will overflow and overtake every single thing. And that all these worries and problems, they will just crumble before You. Because You are the King of Kings and You are the Lord of Lords. So we bring before You, O God, come and heal our people. Come and heal Your people, O Jesus, for Your glory, Lord. So we commit everything to You. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Now we'll stand in the gap. We'll continue to stand in the gap for our nation. I'm reading to you from Psalms chapter 9, verse 7 to 8. But the Lord sits enthroned forever. He has established His throne for justice, and He judges the world with righteousness. He judges the people with uprightness. Church, let's pray together for our country. O God, our Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your love for Malaysia. We pray for cooperation and compliance from all quarters in observing the EMCO enforced in various parts of the Klang Valley. We commit and surrender the reconvening of Your Parliament and State Legislative Assemblies into Your hands. We bring before You all the elected representatives of the people. Awaken them to play their role in producing a crucial check and balance in all ruling policies that affect this nation, both at the federal and state levels. May they focus fully to lead our nation to effectively overcome the current pandemic. We pray for wisdom and unity in address the socio-economic hardship of the people due to the pandemic. Father, may we continually watch and pray for this nation against all works of darkness. Let your kingdom purposes for Malaysia be fulfilled. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Church, it's with our deepest sadness to inform you today of the homegoing of our beloved Sister Celine Khoo. Our dear Sister Celine has gone home to be with the Lord on 10th of July at 5:40 a.m. Sister Celine has brought so much joy and love to us, and so many of us has been blessed in so many ways. While she's in heaven with our dear Abba Father, we will surely miss her here dearly. Our deepest condolences to our beloved Elder Dr. Khoo Kay Hap and all family members in this time of bereavement. May the peace and the love and the comfort of God be with you. And as the church, we grieve with you. And church, if anyone would like to give a love offering, we invite you to go to the Facebook page, FGA Facebook page, as well as our website. And now, let us look to God. Let's look to God in every circumstance, whatever that we are facing in our personal life, in our country. God is still faithful. God is still the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. He has defeated death, and He is worthy. And He continues to bless us and watch over us in whatever circumstance. Let's come into this reality with a thankful heart, and we will do our tithes and offering. We want to thank God and give back a portion of what God has given to us. Let's pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you that you are still a good, good God. You always are. So God, we just want to commit to you this portion of what you have blessed us with. God, use this, Lord, to reach out to those who are lost, who have yet to hear your good news, who need a touch from you. God, use this, Lord, for the expansion of your kingdom, Lord. And Lord, we just praise you for what you can do, for who you are, and we commit our tithes and offerings to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So on the screen right now, you will see the bank details of FGA as well as the Touch and Go QR code. You can scan the code as well as make a bank in to our bank Maybank account. Also, Bantuan FGA account has been reopened for those who are in need at this time. If you have the means to be a blessing, we invite you to donate to this bank details account that is on the screen right now. And please note that these bank details is different than our usual tithes and offerings. So for specific donation for Bantuan FGA, kindly use this bank details and QR code instead. Let's do what we can for those who are in the dire needs. And church, if you have been with us, and if you are new with us sometimes, and today, or even today, is your first time here with us, we welcome you. We can't wait to invite you into our community, and we are so excited that you will meet Jesus as your friend. We hope that this service has been a blessing for you, and we are sure that God has a word for you. So stay with us until the end. And for everyone who have been with us faithfully week in, week out, and you have yet to find a community to be, to journey with you in this faith journey together, can we invite you, as well as our new friends, to scan this QR code on the screen, or take a picture right now, and when you scan the code, it will bring you to a very simple form, and once you fill that up, we will introduce a community to you to be alongside you. Let's do that together as a church. And now, without further ado, we want to welcome our speaker for today, the ever cheerful and passionate for Christ, our sister Christina Phang.
Good morning, FGA. I bring greetings from my home to yours. I trust all of us are surviving our lockdown. I mean, I've lost count on how many days we're in lockdown now. But we praise God that we can still meet together like this. Amen. Hallelujah. As we are going through the book of Matthew today, we are going to land at Matthew chapter 11. Let me just give you an outline of what Matthew 11 comprises. We see, you know, in verse 1, that Jesus, after sending off his 12 disciples, continues his journey to the city of Galilee. Many cities in Galilee continue to proclaim the good news that he was bringing. And as he came to the city, and, you know, John actually sent word through his disciples to ask Jesus whether he was the Messiah. Okay, so, and Jesus had to respond to John. And after responding to John, you know, Jesus continues to affirm John's identity and his ministry. Swiftly, we see then in the middle of the chapter, you know, Jesus started rebuking the unbelief and the unrepentant cities there. And what we see then, right after that, Jesus was also talking about the beautiful relationship that he has with his Father. And finally, you know, Jesus issues this invitation to all of us. Obviously, there's a lot to cover today. So what I would like to focus on is to just look at three things, okay? And what I want to be dealing with is, the first is, how do we deal with the doubts that we face day in, day out in our walk with the Lord? Secondly, you know, how would we address oppositions that may be coming within our home and our work and within our church? And finally, what is our response Jesus' invitation to everyone? Shall we just pray? Father God, we want to thank you and praise you that you are the Almighty, all sovereign Lord. Father, no matter what we are going through now, Father, we thank you, Lord, that you are in the center of it all, Lord. Father, we just want to declare today, oh Father, in spite of whether we are going through good times or bad times, Father, we thank you that we can come to you. And even as we come to you today as your church, Father, we ask that you would just speak to us, Lord. Give us a rhema word this morning, Father, and we just pray that you would come and touch our hearts, oh Father. Touch us, oh Father, Lord, and give us, Lord, that hope to live, Lord, for you and to live for you alone, Father. So we just pray, Lord, that you would just come, Lord, and just move in our midst right now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's just start by reading Matthew 11, verses 2 to 3. When John, who was in prison, heard about the deeds of the Messiah, he sent his disciples to ask him, "Are you the one who is to come, or should we expect someone else?" Verse 4, Jesus replied, "Go back and report to John what you hear and see. The blind receive sight, the lame walk, those who have leprosy are clean, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the good news is proclaimed to the poor. Blessed is anyone who does not stumble on my account." You know, as human beings, all of us have expectations, right? I mean, for those of us who are married, you know, we have expectations on our spouses, our children, and our bosses, our church. And hey, you know, we have high expectations on our government as well, you know. And sometimes, you know, what happens when these expectations are not met? We see here in the scripture, you know, that John, who was assigned the ministry of preparing the way for our Lord, you know, he had expectations of what the kingdom of God would be like, of who the Messiah should be, you know. Then why? Why is John asking, "Are you the Messiah, or should we be seeking someone else?" You know, during this time, when John sent his disciples to ask Jesus this question, you know, John, the Bible tells us that he has been in prison for 1 year. He was put in prison for preaching the truth. And in particular, you know, I mean, he offended Herod, you know, because he rebuked him for committing adultery, you know, by taking his brother's wife, you know. And I think probably John would also be aware that, you know, look, I mean, maybe his time is almost up. He might be losing his head soon. So, I mean, so he's sending his disciples and say, "Ask Jesus, Are you the Messiah? Should we be seeking for someone else? Should we be looking elsewhere? You know, it is very challenging when we have expectations and when things don't turn out the way we expect them to be. And you know, when our prayers, you know, we tell the Lord, you know, we need this, we need that. And, oh Lord, please hear our prayer. And when the answer is not what we expect, it is really difficult. How would we react? Would we be like John and ask, Lord, are you the Messiah? Are you the one that we should be going to, that we should be putting our hope in? You know, I remember as a child, you know, my father had a lot of expectations on me doing well in school. And praise God, I did pretty well. You know, I always, you know, was top of my class. But I remembered at one stage, you know, in my mid-primary years, I got my report card and lo and behold, I didn't get that top position in my class. So, and I knew that I would have, you know, failed my father's expectations. He would be really disappointed with me. And so what happened? So what I did was, I actually foolishly, I decided that I was too afraid to go home. You know, I stayed away from him. I tried to avoid my father, you know, and fortunately, I lived not far from school and they had to send my helper to come and get me because I was walking to school and back. You know, and so often that is what happened to us, right? When someone disappoints us, when you know, our bosses let us down, you know, when our friend let us down, we tend to shy away, you know, and we tend to want to just go away and just don't trust that person anymore, you know. But what did John do? You know, when John, you know, had doubt, you know, when his expectations were not met, he actually sent his disciples to go after Jesus. And what did Jesus do? You know, and Jesus responded, you know, go back and report to John what you see and you hear. The blind receive sight. Hallelujah. The lepers are clean. You know, the dead have been raised to life. So, I mean, go back and tell John. Jesus actually quoted scriptures back to John and reminded him that all that he was talking about, you know, is being fulfilled right before their eyes. You know, so when we have doubts, it's so important, you know, just as John did, you know, he sent his disciples to run after Jesus. You know, we should be going after Jesus. And you know, today, you know, Jesus may not be here to speak that word to us, but the Lord has given us his word. You know, we need to come and confront our doubts and our questions by going back to the word of God. We must not allow our missed expectations, you know, to actually cause us to affect our faith in Jesus Christ. You know, I have been praying and walking with a lot of people. And in the recent times, you know, I received so many prayer requests, you know, to pray for family members who have been stricken by loved ones. And there are many times, you know, some prayers have been answered and some prayers have not been answered. You know, we have lost, you know, friends have lost dear ones to COVID. And so we come to the Lord and we ask, why, Lord? You know, why is it, you know, that we expected you to heal our family member. We expected you to come through for us, but you didn't. You let us down, Lord. So what do we do? You know, just as Jesus, you know, pointed John's disciple to the words of Isaiah, you know, that actually the Lord was, the things that John was preaching about, you know, the Messiah, you know, was doing all these miracles in their towns and that, you know, and Jesus was just reminding John's disciples and reminding John that, Lord, that we can hold on to his word. You know, in Psalms 119, verses 92 to 93, it says, I will never forget your precepts, for by them you have given me life. You know, that is what we need to do in these times where we cannot understand what is happening. You know, a lot of us, you know, we see the suffering, the pain, and unanswered prayers. Even as we look around us, things are not going the way we expect them to be. You know, and yet, you know, what is the Lord encouraging us to do today? You know, the Lord is saying in Isaiah chapter 55 verse 8, you know, the Lord reminds us that his thoughts are not our thoughts and neither our ways His ways. So sometimes, you know, we just need to have faith in God. Let's not, because of a certain unanswered prayer, let's not, because, you know, when our expectations are not met, we turn away, we hide from God, you know, and that is not what we should be doing. The Lord is reminding us, you know, in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5, it says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. And that is what we need to be encouraging one another. You know, we see that when John was in prison, when he was discouraged, when he was in a bad situation, you know, he had his disciples who were around him. So do we, you know, I mean, although we might not be able to meet in church, but hey, you know, we are still able to call our home fellowship members and we are still able to connect with people through Zoom. You know, we are starting a prayer meeting through Zoom now every Wednesday. So I want to encourage you, you know, come and get connected. Come and get connected to your small group through the prayer meetings that the church are putting on, because, you know, we need each other to encourage each other. Just as John's disciples, you know, went to get word from Jesus to go back to encourage John, so we too must be able to come together and lean into our small groups that the FGA provides for us, that together within that small group, you know, as disciples of Jesus Christ, that we will encourage one another even when things look really bad, you know, when things are not going the way we want it to be, and often it doesn't, you know. God is now encouraging us, you know, to just have faith in Him. You know, we must never ever let, you know, our seemingly hopeless and unwanted circumstances and bad circumstances to dictate how we feel about God. You know, Hebrews chapter 10 verse 23 reminds us, you know, to hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for He who promised is faithful. Praise God, you know, throughout the generations, and I'm sure in the history of FGA and our walk with the Lord, you know, there are many occasions, you know, when we can say God is faithful. So when things are going hard, I myself, you know, I went through a really bad patch, you know, when this whole thing about vaccination, to vaccinate or not, and that there's so much confusion that's happening, there's so much fear, there's so much uncertainty, and it's so easy, you know, I myself was, you know, falling into the trap of anxiety, of depression, and yet, you know, I praise and thank God, you know, because I have my home fellowship members, I have my Esther's group, you know, we're able to fellowship and encourage one another. And I want to praise God that because of that, today I can stand before you and I can say, yes, I know, and I know with all my heart, you know, that God is faithful. So I want to encourage brothers and sisters out there, you know, you may be praying and asking God for something for so long, you know, and yet you are not seeing a change in your situation, and yet you are not feeling, you know, that God is meeting your expectations. But hey, you know, the Word of God never lies. We must hold on to the Word of God. And when we feel weak, and when we feel that we are slipping down that slippery slope of unbelief, you know, let's just reach out our hands and reach out to a brother, reach out to a sister and say, hey, I need help. Come along with me, walk with me, help me see, you know, see the trees through the woods, so that I can be able to renew my faith again, to put my trust in God's word again. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, very swiftly after that, when we look at Matthew chapter 11, verses 16 to 24, let's just read it, okay? Matthew chapter 11, verse 16, it says, to what can I compare this generation? They are like children sitting in the marketplace, calling out to the others, we played the pipe for you and you did not dance. We sang a dirge and you did not mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say he has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, here is a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. But wisdom is proved right by her actions. So Jesus quickly turned his attention to the Jews of his generation, you know, a people who were very critical, who had a critical spirit. You know, I mean, he likened that generation to spoiled children. You know, he was saying that, you know, I mean, this, he, like children playing in the marketplace, and when he was referring to playing the pipe, you know, some version said that, you know, the pipe refers to a wedding song, right? And that wedding song represents love, new beginnings, happy days, and a dirge are played during funerals at that time. You know, it signifies ending, death, and sad days. You know, and life is like that, right? We have sort of like the joys of life, you know, the beginning, of a wedding. We welcome a newborn, you know, and yet, you know, it's inevitable that we have to face the sorrows of life. You know, that we will have to face death. You know, it's in our time. You know, we will have to face death on earth. And yet, you know, Jesus was saying that. Jesus was actually commenting about these people, you know, who are very hard to please, just like little children. You know, when we play them a happy song, they refuse to dance. And we play a sad song and they refuse to mourn, right? And they're just complaining people that would not be satisfied, people that have a very critical spirit, okay? So Jesus is not saying that you shouldn't have critical thinking. You know, I'm trained as an engineer, so we are trained to be critical thinking. Having critical thinking is a good trait, but being very critical in spirit, when nothing is ever right and nothing ever sort of like meets your expectations, you know, that is what Jesus is rebuking the people then, right? He was saying, no, the people there were saying, John, he was a crazy person. He was a crazy person. He was living in this funeral mode, right? He lived an overly austere life. But then, what did they charge Jesus with? You know, they charged Jesus with living in that wedding mode, right? I mean, he was feasting and he was making friends with sinners. You know, why did his disciples not fast, right? He appeared to be really living a frivolous life. And I think, you know, in church, that and we need to be careful ourselves as well as Christians. And I mean, there are people who do not believe in Christ, and they're critical. They're critical about us. They're critical about our motives. And often, you know, they question what we do. You know, but what Jesus is saying, you know, what Jesus is saying, you know, he is saying that, you know, why are you a people who cannot be satisfied? Why are you like spoiled children who refuse to accept things as they are? You know, John pointed to Jesus. John pointed the people to Jesus. And Jesus actually pointed the people to the Father. He was the Messiah to come. And yet, the people was expecting someone else. They were critical about what John did. And yet, you know, they were also critical about what Jesus and how Jesus lived his life. You know, so often, you know, we need to ask ourselves, are we like the Jews of that generation? You know, do we criticize everything that doesn't seem not to stick right with us? Okay, and no, in this chapter, you know, Jesus had really stern words for these people. Let's continue reading verses 20 to 24. You know, then Jesus began to denounce the towns in which most of his miracles had been performed because they did not repent. Woe to you, Chorazin! Woe to you, Bethsaida! For if the miracles that were performed in you had been performed in Tyre and Sidon, they would have long repented in sackcloth and ashes. But I tell you, it will be more bearable for Tyre and Sidon on the day of judgment than for you. Verse 23, and you, Capernaum, you know, will you be lifted to the heavens? No, you will go down to Hades. For if the miracles that were performed in you had been performed in Sodom, it would have remained to this day. But I tell you that it will be more bearable for Sodom on that day of judgment than for you. You know, I mean, Chorazin and Bethsaida were cities, you know, that saw a lot of what Jesus was doing. I mean, I read that, you know, actually Bethsaida was the hometown of Andrew, of Philip, and of Peter, you know, and in Capernaum, you know, that's where Jesus did most of his miracles. You know, that was where Peter's mother-in-law was healed, the woman with the issue of blood, you know, received her healing. You know, that's where he touched Jairus' daughter. You know, he set a demonic mute free, right? And it was also the place in Capernaum where actually the you know, you remember the lame man who was lowered down from the roof by four of his friends. Look, Jesus did so many things in those cities, and yet, you know, What was the attitude of these people there? They were unrepentant. You know, you could equate that to being indifferent, you know, and what is Jesus doing? He really opposed, openly, he opposed those who were indifferent. You know, the spirit of indifference is just as bad as a critical spirit. You know, so therefore, you know, what do we do as Christians? You know, we should actually, you know, we should not, we should decide today not to behave like those spoiled children, you know, where we are really difficult people to be satisfied, you know, and you know, what we need to do is when opposition comes our way, right? And when people criticize us, when people are indifferent to the stuff that we're trying to do, you know, we say, oh, look, you know, we are trying to go and share the good news, you know, and look at those cities, right? They saw Jesus in the flesh. They saw him performing miracles, and yet they refuse to believe, and yet they refuse to repent, you know, and yet, because I think, you know, what Jesus was also saying, you know, why did he, you know, compare, you know, the fate of Capernaum and Chorazin and Bethsaida to cities of Tyre and Sidon and Sodom? We knew that those cities were horrible cities, right? And they had major judgment coming to them. And yet Jesus said that these cities, you know, would have fate worse than that. You know, Jesus was also pointing out, another verse in Luke chapter 12, verse 48, the second part, he says, you know, for everyone who has been given much, much will be demanded, and from the one who has been entrusted much, much more will be asked. You know, Jesus has shown his miracles, and yet the people did not believe. So we ask ourselves today, you know, what we should be doing, you know, when things are coming our way, we who have experienced God's goodness, we who have experienced miracles in many ways, you know, just as Jesus did miracles in the biblical times, I'm sure that all of us have a testimony to share, you know. Do not be discouraged, you know, do not sit back, you know. Jesus expects us to really go and really, you know, bring his gospel, be his disciples, you know, to bring his word, so that the lost in this world will continue to hear, you know, what he's doing, you know. And really, what Jesus did was he actually turned that opposition into an opportunity. Because if you look towards the end, you know, when Jesus at verses 25 to 30, you know, if you read it in verse 25, at that time, Jesus said, you know, some verses say, you know, Jesus prayed abruptly, right after, you know, rebuking the cities of that were unrepentant. You know, Jesus quickly said this prayer. You know, in verse 25, it reads, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and learned and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for this is what you were pleased to do. All things have been committed to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal to him. You know, Jesus prayed this beautiful prayer about his intimate relationship, you know, with God the Father, you know, and he was saying that, you know, a lot of these things, you know, God has hidden from the learned, you know, and what Jesus is doing is he's setting that scene and telling us, you know, in order for us to understand the things of God, we need to come to him, you know, like little children. As I said earlier, it's not that Jesus is asking us to, you know, not have critical thinking and just follow blindly. No, no, but Jesus is asking, is praying to the Father, and he's saying, you know, that actually for us to be able to understand the things of God, we need to humble ourselves. We need to come, you know, not as spoiled children, but as children are learning to be able to yearn and to hear what God wants to say to us, you know. And he also made a really clear statement, right, that no one comes to the Father but through Jesus. You know, Jesus said in John 14:6 that that I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me, through Jesus. You know, there is only one way that we can experience, you know, the peace and the power and the presence of God. And Jesus is declaring here, you know, that really, unless He reveals Himself to us, you know, we will not be able to understand the things of God. And here we see, you know, that the famous words in verses 28 to 30. Okay, Matthew 11 verses 28 says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest in your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light." You know, Jesus is issuing an open invitation to all of us. You know, Jesus says to come, to approach Him directly. You know, who is the first person that we run to when we face challenges? A lot of us as kids, we say we run to mommy and daddy, right? And who would we run to, you know, when we have something to complain about? You know, when we want to complain about the government, who do we run to? Nowadays, we can run to social media and post, you know, our opposition and our objections, you know, and our criticism on Facebook. But you know what Jesus is saying? Jesus said, come to Him. Come to Him, all of us, you know, who have a challenge. You know, and Jesus is saying that, you know, a lot of times, actually, you know, a lot of us would run to our home fellowships as well. And today we say, look, we can't run to church because church is closed, right? But hey, Jesus is reminding us in this word. Jesus is saying, come to me. You know, Jesus is asking us, you know, what does it mean to come to Jesus? You know, it means to run to Him, you know, to embrace Him wholeheartedly, you know, because Jesus gave us His own life. And therefore, what Jesus is asking us to do, He is inviting us to come and approach Him boldly. You know, there are many reasons why, you know, many of us feel that, no, I can't go to Jesus, you know, because my life has been really bad. I'm unworthy. I'm not good enough. And to be honest, because Jesus, you failed me so many times, I'm not going to come to you again. Or there's some of us who feel that, look, we are so bad. We don't deserve the love of Jesus. We don't deserve a second chance. You know, Jesus in this verse is telling us, He is issuing this invitation to all of us to come. To come to Him. You know, whatever our problems are, whatever our position is, whatever our past that have been, right? And this invitation is issued to people who actually have a relationship with Jesus Christ, as well as those who have yet to experience what life in Christ is. You know, I just want to talk to you and ask you out there, you know, are you discouraged today? Are you feeling lost? Are you feeling frustrated? It's okay, because I'm feeling, I feel exasperated too. You know, why are the programs that our government is putting up, why is it not working? Why are the cases, you know, the COVID cases keep going up? When are we going to be set free from the prison of our homes? You know, and nothing that we expect is coming true. You know, and this is what Jesus is giving an open invitation to us. Jesus is saying, you know, just come to Him. Come to Him and He will give us rest. You know, Jesus is asking us to come and to rest in Him. Okay, and when I say the word rest, I think all of you would think, okay, I'll go to bed and rest. I will plonk myself down and on the sofa and maybe exercise my fingers, you know, turn on Netflix, Nat Geo, and those sort of thing. You know, the Greek word used for rest here is anapau. Okay, which means, you know, it's the same Hebrew word that was used in Genesis chapter 2 verse 2, which says God rested from His work of creation. You know, the word, the root word here, rest, you know, does not mean just stop doing everything and just sit down and be idle. Okay, it means, you know, to come and perhaps to withdraw from what has been causing us a lot of burden, right? I mean, some of us, you know, have been even tired of you know, at that time when Jesus was speaking to the Jews then, you know, a lot of them were cumbered, you know, with the burden of religion and all the rules that and regulations that they have to follow, you know, and some of us, you know, we have been striving very hard to live our Christian life, you know, as Christians, you know, we want to do the good and yet we don't, you know, there's so many things, you know, that our aspirations, our hopes, you know, don't seem to have been fulfilled, you know, or are dashed. We have to change our plans because of this pandemic, you know, and a lot of us are experiencing this restlessness, this unrest in our spirits. And what is Jesus saying to us today? Jesus is saying, come and approach Him. Come and embrace Him today because He can give us this rest, this refreshing. Okay, when Jesus completed His work of creation, you know, He rested from that work. You know, for us, we need to recognize that Jesus wants us to take time out to be with Him, to come into His embrace so that we can experience, you know, the rest that comes, the refreshing, the repose that comes from Him. I think, you know, what I really like is really reading these two verses from the Message. You know, I'm going to read it to you now. You know, Matthew 11 verses 28 to 30, the Message version. It says, "Are you tired, worn out, burn out on religion? Come to Me. Get away with Me and you recover your life. I will show you how to take real rest. Walk with Me and work with Me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythm of grace. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with Me and you learn to live freely and lightly." You know, what Jesus is calling us is to come into this place of repose, this place of refreshing where we can experience God's peace, God's power, and more importantly, we can feel His presence. So I just want to ask us today, the many of us out there, you know, we are a lot of people saying that we are suffering from pandemic fatigue, right? We are now tired of working from home even, you know, tired of eating everything that is cooked from the home. You know, we are burdened because we are worried about our children's future. You know, we are worried about our own future. We are worried about the future of our country, you know, what the economic situations will be. There are a lot of things that would burden us. You know, just as at the time of Jesus, the Jews were burdened with a lot of to-dos and what-not to-dos. You know, and today, even as we come to the end of today's service, I just want to issue this challenge to all of us, you know. When we come and we face doubts in life, you know, when things are not what we seem to be, when Jesus doesn't seem to be hearing the prayer as we prayed it, you know, what do? Run to Jesus. That is the invitation that Jesus is giving us today. Jesus is saying, come to Me because My yoke is light. You know, and He says here, you know, I mean that, I know that I will not give you anything that is ill-fitting. Jesus understands what we are going through. Jesus knows our doubts. And when we are faced with opposition or when we are tempted to be critical and indifferent, let's just remind ourselves, you know, of the stern words that Jesus spoke to the Jews of that day, you know, the spoiled children who refused to be satisfied. Let us learn to be grateful and be thankful of the things, of the families, of our church that God has given to us through this time of pandemic, that we can journey together, even as we continue to learn to be the disciples of Jesus Christ. And I also want to speak to those of you out there who possibly have not experienced this peace that we are talking about, you know, this hope that we can have in Jesus, the Word of God that we can rely upon, this God who is trustworthy, whose love endures forever. I want to ask you to just open your hearts to Jesus. You know, come to Him. The invitation is open to all. And all we need to do is to come as trusting, and the attitude of a trusting young child, that, you know, a child that would trust that the Father would have the best for him or her. You know, Jesus has the best for our lives. And if we do not have the hope in Jesus, really, it is quite scary out there, isn't it? Every day we wake up to news that are bad news, and the next day we get more bad news. So today, even as we bring our meeting to a close, I just want to challenge ourselves, you know, that we would, when in difficulties, when our expectations are not met, let's not turn away from Jesus. Let's not turn away from our church. Let's not turn away from our brothers and sisters in Christ. Let's not turn away from home fellowships or our CGs. No, let's come together and encourage one another to look to Jesus, to look into the Word of God, to hold on to the promises that are yea and amen for us. And for those of us who do not know Jesus, I just want to give you the opportunity now to reach out your hand and to open up your hearts and to say, Jesus, I want to know what it means to be a child of God. I want to know what it means to experience your rest. I want to know, to learn, you know, what it means to actually, you know, move to the unforced rhythm of grace, God's grace in our lives. So I just want to invite you to just even say this simple prayer with me, inviting the Lord Jesus to come into our hearts. Hallelujah. Let's just pray together. For those of you who do not understand this relationship in Jesus, let's just focus on Him and just pray and ask, Lord Jesus, I ask You to come into my life right now. I ask You to forgive me for trying to live life on my own and doing things in my own way. This day, I ask You to come into my life even as I run into Your embrace today. That God, today I choose to live a life that would follow after Your footsteps, that I choose to live a life that would be hidden in Your Word, so that I can stand on Your truth and Your truth will set me free. So Lord Jesus, come into my heart right now and make me new in Jesus' name. I also want to speak to those who are discouraged. You know, as I say, I have experienced, you know, bouts of discouragement during this time. You know, I just want to say, hey, look, we are not alone in this. You know, we God has put us together, you know, as a fellowship of His people. You know, there are things that we don't understand. There are a lot of questions, you know, that we want to ask, and or questions that are even unanswered, prayers that are unanswered, or at least not in the way that we expected them to be. You know, I just want to encourage you to hang in there. Let's hang in there together as a church. You know, the road ahead may not be easy, you know, but Jesus has promised us rest. Jesus has promised to refresh us. You know, when things are difficult, Jesus is saying, run to Him. Jesus say, come, and I will give you rest. So I just want to encourage you, brothers and sisters, that we would all come to Jesus. We can either come to Him alone, or we can come to Him together, you know, as in your small groups, as a church in FGA, that together we would be able to look to God, you know, so that our doubts can be cleared, you know, so that we will turn, you know, the oppositions that we face into opportunities, so that we can walk in the unforced rhythms of grace. Amen.
Thank you, Sister Christina, for sharing with us your heart and what God has impressed upon your heart. So church and our new friends here, if you feel a stirring in your heart and you want to respond to it, or you would like someone to pray with you, or you simply just want to know more about Jesus, can I encourage you to scan the QR code on the screen? Very often, responding to God's call, it just takes one simple yes and one simple action, one small step. If you scan the QR code, you will be bring to a Zoom room and our pastors will be there to pray with you and journey with you. And for the rest of us, let's close the service in prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank You so much for always wanting to speak to us. Help us, Lord, to receive what You have spoken and what You want to speak to us with an open heart. And help us, God, to be always sensitive to what You are doing in our midst. And Lord, may You continue to be with us and help us to yield to You, to know what You are doing, and that we will will welcome your kingdom on earth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So church, have a great week ahead. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May His face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn His face towards you and give you peace. God bless you. Have a great week ahead.